Hi, my name is Lorna Mothania Ochido, and I'm making it one of my life's mission to demystify the speech therapy field and to empower more parents on what they can start to do in order to optimize their child's communication outcomes. So whether you want your child to talk more or talk better, learn better, and overall optimize their potential. So stay tuned and feel free to send in any topics on speech and language development you'd like to know. Welcome to today's What Is series, and in today's What Is series I am talking about the topic of what is fluid in the ears. So there's such a thing, yes, as fluid in the ears, and a lot of children, you'd not believe this, have fluid in the ears as a problem, a real problem for them, that is the reason why they might be delayed in developing timely speech or language skills. So the technical term for fluid in the ears is otitis media. The reason why children tend to have fluid trapped in the middle ear is really it's because of the anatomy of a child's face. So a child's face compared to an adult's face, the nose is almost at the same level as the ear. So when there's ever, you know, if your child is congested, has a cold, then the fluid that comes as a result of the cold or the congestion doesn't actually get a chance to drain down properly. As an adult or as they get older, then the ear moves slightly up, so it's not really at the same level as the nose, and so then that usually sorts itself out. So if you have a cold, it drains well, it doesn't sit in the ears. So what's the big deal about fluid in the ears? A lot of children who are delayed in their speech skills or their language skills can sometimes have fluid in the ears or otitis media be the reason why they are delayed. Because you can imagine, so fluid gets trapped in the middle ear. So this is the outer ear, then there's the middle ear, and then there's a hearing organ which is housed in the inner ear. So if there's any fluid that is trapped in that pathway, then the child is not getting a clear enough sound signal. So yes, they can hear, but it's not getting very clear for them, you know, the kind of clarity that is required to actually get them to develop speech. So it's almost the feeling of when you've gone swimming and you have water that is trapped in your ears, and it sometimes can get quite uncomfortable. So you're thinking, okay, your child has probably never had an ear infection. I say to parents that not all children actually end up complaining of an ear infection. It's when the ear infection is so severe that your child complains about it. So your child can actually silently be trapping fluid in the ears without you realizing. So if your child is not speaking at the time that, you know, they're expected to speak, or they don't have adequate vocabulary, or their pronunciation, so their speech isn't very clear, then at your speech therapist visit, the speech therapist might order a hearing test. And in Kenya, I know for sure, in Kenya specifically, the test that is used to determine if there's fluid in the middle ear is usually standard to the hearing test that most audiologists would do. I know at Gertrude's Hospital for sure, they will always test the middle ear and the inner ear. I mean, it makes no sense to just test the inner ear when maybe it's the pathway that is blocked with fluid. So the test that is used to determine if there's fluid in the middle ear is called tympanometry. There's another video in this series that talks a lot about, you know, the specific tests and what they test. So I would urge you, if you're interested in learning more, to check that series out. So the test is pretty simple, and it tells us if the child has fluid in the ears or not. And so what do you do if your child actually has fluid in the ears? It's very simple. I recommend that you repeat the test maybe after a month. And also, it is not a good idea to test when your child is already experiencing a cold, because they are most likely to actually fail that test. Because a lot of children will usually have fluid in the middle ear when they have a cold, but it resolves by itself when the cold resolves. But for some children, it becomes problematic and it gets trapped there, particularly children who have, you know, enlarged adenoids. And again, there's another video that talks in depth about what adenoids, enlarged adenoids, are and how they impact on speech and language development. So if there's fluid in the ears, repeat the test after 1 month to make sure that you know your child, it's not a chronic condition, so it's not chronic otitis media. And if they fail at the second testing, then it's probably a good idea to see an ENT. I mean, you could see an ENT before that period, but really there's no indication for any intervention. And there is an intervention that corrects the fluid, the situation, and that's usually surgical intervention. It's a procedure called meningectomy, where they drain the fluid. I have not actually heard a case where meningectomy is done in isolation. Usually it's done in conjunction with another procedure like adenoidectomy or adenotonsillectomy. So they drain the fluid. So the draining of the fluid is referred to as meningectomy. And if the ENT surgeon feels that the condition is chronic enough, you know, because you tested month one, failed, tested month two, failed, maybe you even tested month three or previously and the child has consistently failed the middle ear test, then the ENT might see it fit to actually put some tubes in. And I know it sounds scary, you know, tubes in your child's ears, but it's really, really quite safe. The tubes are referred to as grommets. So most people just refer to them as tubes. And the tubes are put inside your child's middle ear and they sit there. They actually open the eardrum. So they open the pathway so that any fluid is able to drain. And when your child no longer needs to drain fluid because maybe there's no more fluid or they're just doing it independently, then these grommets or tubes fall out by themselves. So I think it's really important to give that note that the tubes do fall out, because I've seen parents who hadn't been informed that the tubes will actually fall out and they suddenly see this thing coming out of their child's ears and it's usually not clean. So after the grommets have been inserted or meningectomy procedure has taken place, then it's a good idea to visit, you know, to revisit your speech therapist if they're not the ones who referred you for the hearing test to begin with, and then start the journey of speech therapy. I also, as a matter of precaution, will recommend that if, say, tubes were put in, that you repeat the TIMP test again, maybe after another month, to make sure that fluid isn't continuing to be trapped, because that can also happen. Or the grommets or the tubes could actually get clogged. You know, they could get clogged, and there's usually a test. I'm not sure that all the audiologists in Kenya do perform this test to see if the grommets are open, but I hear, as a matter of deduction, by measuring, you know, when you do the TIMP and you measure the ear canal volume, I think you're able to determine if the grommets are actually open or not, or if they're actually present in situ or not. But there's a test, I think it's called this impedus test. I'll make sure to put that in the blog. The impedus test checks to see if the eardrum is actually compliant. So something to do with that. I'll make sure to make it really clear in the blog. So yeah, so that is otitis media and how and the reason why it is quite important. So there you have it. I hope this series has clarified what fluid in the ears is, or what is otitis media, and how that can impact on a child's speech and language development. As always, thank you so much for tuning in. Feel free to check out our other series if this particular series has raised any topics that you feel you'd like to explore. Thank you so much.